An organism's metabolism is the totality of an organism's chemical reactions consisting of catabolic and anabolic pathways. Metabolic pathways are a series of chemical reactions that either build a complex molecule or break down a complex molecule into more simpler compounds. Catabolic pathway is metabolic pathways that release energy by breaking down complex molecules into simple molecules. Anabolic pathways are metabolic pathways that synthesize a complex molecule from simpler compounds. Kinetic energy is energy of motion, directly related to the speed of motion. Potential energy is energy stored by matter as a result of its location or spatial arrangement. Thermal energy is the amount of kinetic energy due to molecular motion in a body of matter. Thermal energy is an energy in its most random form. Chemical energy is energy stored in the chemical bonds of molecules, a form of potential energy. And thermodynamics is the study of energy transformations that occur in the collection of matter. The first law of thermodynamics is the principle of conservation of energy. Energy cannot be created or destroyed, but can be transferred or transformed. The second law of thermodynamics is the principle where every energy transfer or transformation increases the entropy of the universe. Ordered forms of heat are at least partly converted to heat, and in spontaneous reactions, the free energy of the system also decreases. Entropy is a quantitative measure of disorder or randomness, symbolized by S.
The concept of free energy provides a useful function for measuring spontaneity of a system. Unlike a plant who would need sunlight to grow, spontaneous free energy doesn't need an outside source of energy to carry out its reaction. Free energy is the part of a system's energy that's able to perform work when temperature and pressure are uniform throughout the system, like in a living cell. Spontaneous reactions have negative change in free energy, represented by G. Entropy is a measure of disorder or randomness in a collection of matter. Enthalpy is the equivalent of energy. To calculate the free energy change that occurs when a system changes, like during a chemical reaction, you can use the formula G equals H minus TS, where G is the change in free energy, H stands for the change in the system's enthalpy, T stands for the temperature in Kelvin units, and S represents entropy. It can also be represented by the difference between the free energy of the final state and the free energy of the initial state. What remains is the free energy available for work. Free energy can be thought of as a measure of the stability of a system. For example, a diver on top of a platform is less stable than when he's floating in water. A drop of concentrated dye is less stable than when it is spread randomly through the liquid. And a sugar molecule is less stable than the simpler molecules into which it can be broken up into. Systems that are high in free energy are more unstable and tend to move toward a more stable state, or one with less free energy. When a system reaches a state of maximum stability, it's known as equilibrium. At chemical equilibrium, the system can do no work. A process is spontaneous and can perform work only when it is moving toward equilibrium. Movements away from equilibrium require the addition of energy from an outside energy source, or the surrounding. Chemical reactions can be classified as either exergonic or endergonic based on their free energy. An exergonic reaction proceeds with a net release of free energy. Free energy is negative for an exergonic reaction because the chemical mixture loses energy in order to make its final product. An endergonic reaction is one that absorbs free energy from its surroundings. Because endergonic reactions essentially store free energy in molecules, endergonic reactions have positive free energy. Endergonic reactions are non-spontaneous, and the magnitude of the change in free energy is the quantity of the energy required to drive the reaction. If a chemical process is exergonic, or downhill, in one direction, then the reverse process must be endergonic, or uphill. For example, if cellular respiration releases 686 kcal, then photosynthesis, the reverse action, must require an equivalent investment of energy. Reactions in a closed system eventually reach equilibrium and can do no work. For example, a closed hydroelectric system would eventually reach a state of equilibrium and stop working. A cell that has reached a metabolic equilibrium has a free energy equivalent to zero and is dead. Therefore, metabolic disequilibrium is one of the defining features of life. Cells maintain disequilibrium because they are open systems. The constant flow of materials into and out of the cell keeps metabolic pathways from ever reaching equilibrium. An example is an open hydroelectric system, where flowing water keeps driving the generator because the intake and outflow of water keeps the system from reaching equilibrium. But a catabolic process in a cell releases free energy in a series of reactions, not a single step. Cellular respiration is a lot like a multi-step open hydroelectric system. Glucose is broken down in a series of exergonic reactions that power the works of the cell. The product of each reaction becomes the reactant for the next, so no reaction reaches equilibrium. Some reverse reactions of respiration are constantly pulled in one direction. As the product of one reaction does not accumulate but becomes the reactant in the next step. Sunlight provides a daily source of free energy for photosynthetic organisms. Non-photosynthetic organisms depend on the transfer of free energy from photosynthetic organisms in the form of organic molecules.
Mechanical work is the contraction of muscle cells and is the movement of chromosomes during cellular reproduction. Transport work is the pumping of substances across membranes against the direction of spontaneous movement. Chemical work is the pushing of energonic reactions which would not occur spontaneously. The structure of ATP contains sugar ribose with a nitrogenous base adenine and a chain of three phosphate groups bonded to it. ATP is hydrolyzed when it is in equilibrium with water. ATP performs three types of work. For mechanical work, ATP phosphorylates motor proteins. For transport work, they transport proteins. And for chemical work, the key reactants. ATP is regenerated by the addition of phosphate to ADP. The free energy required to phosphorylate ADP comes from energonic breakdown reactions in the cell. This shuttling of an inorganic phosphate and energy is called the ATP cycle, and it couples the cell's energy-yielding processes to the energy-consuming ones. The ATP cycle moves at an astonishing pace.
Enzymes are large proteins that bind small molecules. When bound to an enzyme, the bonds in the reactants can be strained, thereby making it easier for them to achieve the transition state, and when the reactants reach the transition state, the bonds will break and new bonds will form, releasing energy to the surroundings, therefore creating products. The catalytic cycle is the cycle that turns substrates into products, and the active site is the enzyme that the substrates get put into to form these products. The catalytic cycle starts with the substrates entering the active site, and the enzyme forms the shape of the substrates. These substrates are held in the active site by weak interactions such as hydrogen and ionic bonds. Then the active site lowers the activation energy and speeds up the reaction. Finally, the substrates are converted into products and released. Temperature impacts enzymes up to a point. With increasing temperature, substrates collide with active sites more frequently when the molecule moves rapidly. But when you pass that point of too much heat, the enzymatic reaction drops sharply. When it's past that point, it agitates the hydrogen and ionic bonds. But all enzymes work at different temperatures, so it just depends where the enzyme is located. With pH, most enzymes fall in the range of pH 6 to 8, but there are exceptions such as pepsin, which is a digestive enzyme in the stomach, and that works best at a pH of 2. And there is a trypsin, which is also a digestive enzyme that works best at a pH of 8. So with pH, it just depends on what type of enzyme it is. Enzymes are inhibited by competitive and non-competitive inhibition. Competitive inhibition is where the inhibitor mimics the substrate, competing for the active site, while the non-competitive inhibitor binds to the enzyme away from the active site, causing the real active site to no longer function.
An activator and an inhibitor can have different effects on an allosterically regulated enzyme, and that they may bind at different sites on the enzyme. This will then result in changing the conformation or activity of the enzyme in different ways.